a scene certainly that I never forget.
We held on to each other and we just screamed at each other.
You'd never see anything as bad as what Don was. Never.
People in Castle Street were cheering every time a bomb went off.
I thought we were going to be burnt alive.
These memories will always stay in my head. It wasn't a tale that somebody told you, you were there and witnessed it.
On the 21st of July, 1972, the IRA unleashed its biggest ever day of bombing. It was known as Bloody Friday. By the summer of 1972, the troubles had been raging for 3 years. Somehow, normal life went on.
And they called it puppy love.
Donny Osmond provided the soundtrack to the summer.
Because we're in our teens.
There were only three TV channels.
You're watching BBC One Northern Ireland.
Full of industrial strikes, war, and political upheaval. Twelve-year-old Neil Reid was the youngest chart topper in history. Here, history had taken a darker turn.
Your security gates across that street, your dog handlers standing in the security gates, you went to go into a shop, you were searched, you were frisked, your handbag was opened.
The IRA were at their peak. The introduction of internment and the bloodshed and Bloody Sunday had recruits flooding in. Unionists protested when Stormont was abolished in March. It seemed like a victory for a confident Republican movement. On the other side of the barricade, loyalist paramilitary groups were growing too. The UDA now had 40,000 members and dozens of sectarian murders to its name.
Everybody became a troubles junkie. Where was the next atrocity? What was happening? Who was in it? Was it family? Was it friends?
The IRA had a new weapon, the car bomb. It was the perfect way to transport explosives. When it went off, it turned glass and metal into deadly shrapnel. The bombers could park wherever and whenever they liked.
The only blessing was that the IRA seemed to not want to go out laying bombs before lunchtime. So we always knew that it was like to be quiet in the mornings, and it would kick off in the afternoon and evening.
With help from their deadly new weapon, the IRA believed it would take just one last push to get victory. They started to plan an operation so big the government would have to take them seriously. At the same time, a back channel had started secret talks, and in June they called a ceasefire. They felt they had arrived.
Showing that they were big shots and that they were dealing at the top that they held real power.
In a community centre in Derry, the IRA's main players held a press conference and spelled out their conditions for talks. Martin McGuinness was there, only 22, but already second in command in Derry. Alongside him, Dahi O'Connell, overall number two, Sean McStayfoyne, chief of staff, and Seamus Toomey, Belfast commander.
They haven't beaten the IRA, they're not going to beat the IRA. The only way to establish peace in Ireland is to sit down and talk to the leadership of the IRA.
Seamus Toomey tried to claim the moral high ground.
If we really wanted to commit a sectarian war, we could start it in an hour's time. But we don't want to do that. We've no wish. We wish to avoid this at all costs.
On the 7th of July, the British establishment met the IRA in secret. The venue was a palatial private house at 96 Cheney Walk beside the Thames in Chelsea. The delegation included the leadership team at the news conference, with a significant addition, Gerry Adams. At just 23, he was already a big enough player to be released from internment for the talks. There was no denial it was anything other than an IRA delegation.
All were IRA?
Yes. Not Sinn Féin, but IRA.
All of them?
Yes.
For several hours they sat face to face. The IRA's key demand was for British withdrawal.
The IRA overplayed their hand, and the British government representatives thought, these guys are just preposterous.
State of mind was totally negative, and the meeting was a non-event.
2 days later, there was a gun battle in Lenadoon.
It looked and sounded very much like the end of the ceasefire. The army are up here in the middle of Lenadoon Avenue. They'd come here after...
The ceasefire was over. For now, plans for peace talks were on hold. Plans for that spectacular day of bombing back on the table. They needed to show they hadn't gone away. In a school in West Belfast, the leadership met to organise the bombing. The plan? To pack as many explosions as possible into a single hour.
In the run-up to Bloody Friday, we knew that a lot of explosive had been coming into the city. The reason we knew is that some of the vehicle control point guys had stopped old chaps driving nice new cars full of explosives. And they'd be coming up from the south.
The timers came from parking meters in America. They'd been posted to a safe house in West Belfast and divided between bomb factories in the markets, New Lodge in North Belfast, and West Belfast. The engineers started to assemble the bombs, adding timers and detonators to packages of nitrobenzene. They were now ready to be driven to their targets.
I've two images that come to mind. First was before the bomb, of a sunny summer's day, of the waterworks full of bubbling water, people laughing, cars moving.
It was just a real typical, lovely summer day, you know, really nice warm weather and nothing unreal about it or strange.
It was a fairly ordinary day, until about lunchtime, until about 12 o'clock.
It was the end of the 12th fortnight, and many families had holiday plans.
The boys were in Scotland with the Cubs, and they were due back on the Saturday, and we were thinking of heading to Newcastle the following week.
Hugh O'Hare was an accountant with a thriving practice. He and his wife Margaret had seven children.
I was speaking to Margaret that morning, Friday morning, and said I had a meeting in Dundalk, and not to bother about tea, I'd be home sometime about 8 or 9, and we'd make arrangements to head off at the beginning of the week.
She was really fantastic. She was very vivacious, very vibrant, loved children, nothing was a problem. Everybody loved her. I mean, she was a fun auntie.
Around lunchtime, a series of hoax bomb calls brought chaos to the roads around Belfast, making it hard for the police and army to move around. It was all part of the plan. A man driving a grey Ford Cortina stopped at a pedestrian crossing at Old Park Avenue. Two men in their early 20s pointed a gun through the open window and said they wanted the loan of his car. The owner was forced to drive to Cliftonville Circus, down the Old Park Road to the opposite end of Old Park Avenue. In the Albert Street Mill and the Lower Falls, soldier Stephen Cooper was on his lunch break when he rang his sister.
He was happy. He wanted everyone to know that he got all his birthday cards early because he was going to be 19 the next day. And I think the lads were going to take him out and do something to celebrate his birthday.
Most of these entries are very brief because there's a hell of a lot of time to make notes. There was no real respite other than you had a day when you were stood down.
Colin Tennant was on call with the bomb disposal team. Around 1:30, they got their first call of the day. Explosives have been attached to the pylons underneath the Albert Bridge.
While we were dealing with that and trying to clear it up, the radio started really to crackle. Then we started to get these calls in from brigade saying, here's another incident and another.
On Old Park Avenue in North Belfast, an IRA man took over the hijacked Ford Cortina. He collected a bomb from a house in the New Lodge and placed it on the back seat. He covered it with brown tarpaulin and drove it towards the Cave Hill shops. Around 2:15, he parked it outside the drapery shop, next door to the fruit shop. Just yards away, milkman Richard Young had finished his round and was having a cup of tea.
When I came out, I noticed there was a grey car sitting here, and I wondered at the time what it was doing there.
As it was the end of the 12th fortnight, the train and bus stations were jammed with holiday traffic. At Oxford Street, 15-year-old Billy Crothers had just done his first week as a parcel boy.
The only thing Billy was interested in was football. That was his life. And Bob Bishop, who ran the football training place. And they were just like two old mates together.
After work that day, Billy was due to go to a football camp run by the Manchester United scout.
Mum wanted Billy to stay at school. And he said no, he wanted to get a job just to help Mum. And Mum said he came home as proud as punch for his lunch, and he gave her all the wage packet.
A neighbour saw Billy running back to the depot for his afternoon's work. In the markets, a bakery worker noticed his car missing. The blue Austin 1100 had been stolen and the boot packed with a £100 bomb. At 2:20, it was primed and began its journey from Stanfield Street towards the bus station. The 24-year-old man at the wheel had never even passed a driving test.
That's horrific, because that guy carrying a fully primed bomb that's ticking down, that's shocking.
We had come from a youth camp on the Isle of Man by ferry.
Jackie Gibson was a bus driver on his way back to Oxford Street.
Coming up to the far end of the Castley Road going out of town, I can remember seeing an Ulster bus sitting at a bus stop. I looked twice and I realised it was my father, but it was a fleeting enough glance. That was about 2:30.
The man driving the bomb found himself stuck in traffic until a policeman waved him through. He parked at the back of the bus station where the drivers paid in their takings. With the bomb in place, he went round the corner to Mooney's pub and ordered a whiskey. 12 minutes later, a caller rang from a house in Cromick Street in the markets and warned the police there was a massive bomb at the bus station. But the line to the depot was busy, so the police rang the army who dispatched a patrol. Among them, Stephen Cooper, who had been on the phone to his sister.
I heard someone talking in the background and he asked me to wait a minute because he'd got to talk to someone. And then when he came back to the phone, he said that his sergeant needed him. He had to go out on a call, on a hoax call, he thought. And the last thing I said was to keep your head down. And he said, don't worry, I do. I'm not silly.
Philip Galt was from the new lodge in North Belfast. He was 9 years old and was shopping with his mother on the limestone road when they were moved away from a bomb scare. They found themselves outside a bank.
A vehicle was parked just about here. I was walking up and, as all youngsters do, we'll just basically leant against the vehicle.
Philip and his mother had been moved towards a car that contained a 50-pound bomb. That was 20-3 and the first explosion of the day. There'd been no warning.
It was so close proximity that when the bomb went off, I went off with it, basically.
Philip was blown 10 feet into the air by the force of the blast.
I always remember looking at the Ulster Bank thing. And then all of a sudden you're sitting here in the ground looking at a pool of blood and seeing the aftermath, the wound. Not knowing where my mother was at that stage, not knowing where anybody was. And just that sheer panic. You know, it's probably the worst panic you'll ever come across.
5 minutes later, on Botanic Avenue in South Belfast, a bomb in a bread van went off. And blew the leaves off the trees.
I remember the ambulance going at tremendous speeds, I thought, as a nine-year-old, through Belfast City Centre. Various instructions and information coming through from the different control areas, and you were hearing, you know, bombs going off, sirens going everywhere.
Next was the Queen Elizabeth Bridge. Two minutes later, the gas works on Ormo Avenue. In the midst of the chaos, Jackie Gibson drove his bus into the depot at the end of his shift. He parked and went to pay in his takings.
They came to the office window and he told people within the office to be careful. A bomb had exploded on the Queen Elizabeth Bridge.
We tried to get out of there to see what we could do. Couldn't get out. There were people running and panicking, not surprisingly, in all directions. And one way or another, it was just mayhem.
People were escaping from one bomb only to become the target of another.
We were just running blind. The next crack that came among this cacophony of calamity that was exploding, a necklace of bombs all around the city.
It was quite awful to see all that. Particularly in Belfast, where usually people were very good. They used to clear areas down quickly, move out of the way. Not that day.
This area was filled in mass with people. And we all started to get pushed up towards the city hall.
Kevin Sheehy was a constable in the RUC. The police were struggling to cope in the chaos.
People were straining right and left. And all of a sudden there was this huge explosion which seemed to be just behind the city hall. So everyone started to stampede back.
It was like being in an amphitheatre with the gladiators coming at you, because it was just next, where's that, where's that, where's that?
So far, six bombs had gone off. In the city centre there was terror and confusion. On the Cave Hill Road, just a short distance away, the normal rhythms of a summer's day went on.
Margaret came up to the house and she asked me would I take her children to the shops.
Brenda and her friend Jackie were inseparable, so she went along too. In total, five children headed towards the Cave Hill shops.
From the town, we could hear the sounds of bombs going off. But we still kept walking.
Yeah,
I suppose it's
mum and dad as well, Brenda.
Oh, did we?
My mum and dad were shopping and they came past us in the park and they said, girls, don't be too long because there's a lot of things gone off in town.
Bridgetta Murray had finished her shopping for the weekend, but had a sweet tooth and had called into Thompson's Bakery to buy cakes.
They had a wonderful lifestyle. They were wealthy and loved in a quite, how can I say, upper class area within the Antrim Road.
Also at the Cave Hill shops was schoolboy Stephen Parker. He had a part-time job there. He was 14, always cheerful and helpful.
Stephen was a complete extrovert, full of life and fun and always playing jokes.
I said, you've got to go up the road to do your Friday afternoon job, which was washing a car and getting messages for Lady Home, one of the shops up the road. Oh, he said, but I haven't got to be up there till 3:30. And I said, oh, well, I think you ought to go early. She does like you early.
Around 3, a van bomb went off without warning at an electricity substation in Salisbury Avenue, North Belfast. York Street railway station was next. A man and a woman left a bomb in a suitcase.
It was just chaos. People screaming, people falling to the ground, and glass everywhere. Just chaos. Nobody knew what they were doing. People were on the boat all. I was the same, to tell you the truth. The shock kept me going.
As the warning calls came in, the police tried to clear each area in turn. Bill McKnight was based in Andersonstown RUC station. As a break from West Belfast, his boss sent him on traffic duty for a day in the city centre.
My most vivid recollection was of a young woman with 2 or 3 kiddies, and they all were in absolute and total hysterics. And I'm directing them down one street, and of course some policeman doing his job at the bottom of the street turned them back up again. I run into them 2 or 3 times, and the terror in that young family's eyes, they were screaming hysterically.
I remember working in this garage here. Well, it was a garage then, Dickon Company, Donegal Street here.
John Lennon, better known as the entertainer May McFetridge, was a mechanic working underneath a jacked up car. Two men left a bomb at Smithfield bus station. As they ran off, they told 2 children to shout a warning.
We left and I came out to just this spot, and I saw the next thing, boom, the whole place shut. And I went back, and then the car that I had been working on had fallen off the jack. And there was no wheels in the back, it just hit the ground. So literally, if I hadn't been out being nosy, God knows what would have happened, you know what I mean?
The IRA man who left that bomb was Jerry Bradley. He left another one at Eastward Motors. Historian Brian Feeney has written a book about him.
He actually had to kick one of the people in the garage, because when he came in with his bomb and shouting to people that this was a bomb, they didn't react quickly enough. He walked out with the driver, and as they walked out, a military police jeep drew up and parked about 20 feet away. And he said, they just decided to keep cool and keep walking and not running. So they walked to their car and got in and drove away.
John Lenehan and the other apprentices were told to save the cars.
When you think about it now, you know, get the cars out, you know, these are new cars, doesn't matter about you. Think, I have plenty of apprentices in the brew, get the cars out.
At Oxford Street station, a 7-man patrol from the Welsh Guards arrived. The workers knew there was a bomb, but they didn't know where. Tom Killips, Billy Crothers, and Billy Irvine went to look. The soldier's driver was 18-year-old Stephen Cooper. He dropped the others off and parked the armoured vehicle at the back of the depot. Manager Jack Campbell saw a suspicious car and looked to see if it had a staff sticker.
My father saw a car that he didn't recognise and he leaned across it.
Stephen and his sergeant were standing next to the car that the bomb was in.
The Oxford Street bomb went off just after 3 o'clock. The warning had given staff and soldiers just 20 minutes to find it. Colin Tennant was still gridlocked on the Albert Bridge.
I remember the force of the explosion, even though it was the other side of a wall, and thinking that was big. We could hear people screaming from where we were.
Milkman Bernard McTasney was on his way home from his deliveries.
Turned into Oxford Street. The lights was against us, and we were sitting there about 2 or 3 seconds when the bombs went off. And everyone in the car was shattered.
Richard Lennon, a student with a summer job at the depot, was one of the first on the scene.
The thing that I noticed about it was so quiet. You know, all this devastation around, and there wasn't a sound. Not a sound of a bird or anything.
In the aftermath, he found a workmate.
He was wandering around the office, no shirt on and no shoes on. And I said to him, what happened to you? And he just looked at me like he was gone.
An ambulance man come over and grabbed me. He said, come on, you get in this ambulance. He said, let him over, it was nothing wrong with me. He said, oh, yes, sir, there was a big piece of shrapnel behind your left ear. I didn't even feel it going in.
Bomb after bomb had gone off with just a few minutes in between. The bombers found themselves caught up in the very chaos they'd created.
As the bombs started to go off and road checks were mounted and chaos started to happen, as they drove in, they're starting to run out of time. They can't stop the bomb. They don't know how to do it. In a couple of cases, they actually had to leave the car and run.
In just 32 minutes, 17 bombs had exploded across Belfast. The Cave Hill shops seemed to be outside the danger zone. But the timer on the 18th bomb was ticking down.
We passed the car, which was outside the shop.
The vets.
The five of us walked past, and we would have been right up against this car. We walked past it, and then we heard a bomb go off down that way, and we went out to the edge and had a look down and whatever, and then we walked back up past the car. So we went past
the sweet shop.
And then into the chalk box.
Stephen Parker had seen the bomb on the back seat of the car. When the girls were in the sweet shop, he was running from door to door shouting, "Bomb! Bomb!" Margaret heard the explosions going off across the city. She ran from her brother's house and drove off to find the children. She parked, then ran towards the shop.
I thought I saw Margaret getting out of the car, because I went to say to Brenda, "There's your aunt."
And, of course, she walked across the pavement. The car was sitting there. And off it went.
Suddenly, there was a most terrific blast. And it was, and I looked, I could see the smoke rising from the Cave Hill Road. Well, I knew, without any doubt, it was there.
I could see the pencils falling down and rubbers and little exercise books and things.
I just remember this deadly silence, you know, like deafened. I felt really deafened and I couldn't hear. I felt like I couldn't hear, but I knew that we were screaming and panicking.
And I think we held on to each other and we just screamed at each other. We just really...
We didn't think we were going
to get out. We genuinely didn't. As 9-year-olds, we thought we were going to die in the shop.
I just ran as I was. As a matter of fact, I remember running without my shoes because there were these flip-flops that slip off your feet, and I took them off and ran because I knew he was there.
We tried to get out at the front, but the front was on fire. We were trapped in. I mean, it was absolutely on fire. There was no question of getting out of the front of the shop.
I thought we were going to be burnt alive, and we were just screaming and holding on to each other.
Across the city, plumes of smoke scarred the skies. At the bus station, the rescuers were starting to see the horror through the haze.
There was a military policeman standing in the middle of the street, and he was trying to hold people back and shouting at people trying to get to the dead and injured, "Do you not understand English?"
The full horror of Bloody Friday was beginning to sink in.
And there's soldiers just about to put a blanket, what was left of a blanket, over one of their dead colleagues lying on the ground.
Bus cleaner came down with a shovel and he started clearing up. Now he was clearing up glass and bits of brick and everything else, among which were bodies.
The keening of the wounded and the distress of the people who went to help them. And the heroes were the ambulance men, the policemen who went in there, not knowing if there was another device.
A lot of blood and bodies, bits of bodies lying all around the place.
One of those policemen was Jack Dale, who was blown off his feet on his way to the bus station.
We found a woman's or a man's skull, which had gone through railings.
Into the worst of it went the ambulance crews of Belfast.
It was just devastation, complete devastation. Buses were burning and people were running about.
John Knox was a part-time fireman.
There was obviously lots of smoke and fire from the building. People seemed to be going in and out as if they were going in and out of clouds. And it wasn't always possible to see the bodies on the ground clearly.
Andy Jenkins had been dealing with the Ormo Avenue bomb when Oxford Street went off.
They actually had a tarpaulin out, and most of the chaps that were there were over and were looking at it, and it was absolutely horrendous. I don't know why, there were mangled bodies and bits and pieces, and it was unbelievable.
Some of the crew were given plastic bags and a shovel to go around collecting bits of bodies.
We got two or three different patients, as you would call them, to take into the ambulance, but they weren't really patients for us at that particular time.
When they saw the ambulance crew bringing one of the bodies out of the bus station, there wasn't a stitch on him. His body was just like a raw piece of meat. They knew what you were handling, and we knew it was somebody's loved one.
We were told to stand by that we would have to take these people to the Royal to get them certified. When we got to the Royal, one of them was so badly injured that they had to get a special doctor down for to look at it to try and make up his mind whether it was a male or female.
It wasn't just the mutilated bodies that shocked the rescue workers that day.
There was a large group of people standing down at the markets area, And every time a bomb went off, they jeered and shouted and yelled as if they thought it was a good thing.
Jack Campbell, who'd been leaning on the car that exploded, was blown onto the bus station roof. By the standards of the day, he had a remarkable escape.
He was practically unrecognisable. His teeth had been blown out. His arms were broken. His legs were broken. His ribs were broken. A lot of the skin in his body had been blown off. The jelly in the back of his eyes had been shaken up. And when they looked, they did realise that it was him and that he was just about alive.
In Cave Hill, the five children, aged from 3 to 11, had managed to get out of the sweet shop, but had to step over the shop owner, Vera Bowden.
Just in front of me, and I remember this distinctly, was this Bowden sister. Her clothes were torn to shreds, and there were hacks out of her body, and I remember looking at this, and I just couldn't take it in.
Vera Bowden survived the bomb, but was badly injured. For the rest of her life, she needed constant care.
I remember even as a nine-year-old counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I thought, oh, thank goodness, there's five of us, you know, that's okay, the five's okay.
I went into the fruit shop and I seen a piece of hair and that. And I went and pulled away and I seen a young fella, just seen his face and he was blue to pieces.
Stephen Parker risked his own life warning other people to get away from the bomb. When it exploded, he was hit with the full force of the blast and died instantly.
And then we went into the baker shop and there was an old woman lying.
The woman was 68-year-old Bridgetta Murray.
It was a very safe, nice area, able to go about your daily business, and then all of a sudden a massive explosion just removed her from this earth.
Now we come up here, there's some other woman lying here. She was dead.
Margaret O'Hare had parked her Mini right beside the car with the bomb. As she ran to find her children, it exploded. She died instantly. She was just 35. Eighteen bombs had exploded in less than an hour. The final explosion of the day was at Great Victoria Street Station. A bomb in a van went off at 4 o'clock. The IRA had planted 23 bombs. They had intended their bombing spree to be even bigger, but two failed to go off, and two were defused.
I remember waking up in a hospital bed with my mother and father there, and the first thing I seen was a cage over my legs, and the fear, this total fear of where are my legs?
I ended up in blind panic, as you can imagine, when I got home. Pram sitting in the driveway and nobody there, empty house. Within minutes, people seemed to emerge from everywhere. You know, don't ask me, I don't really know where they came from. They had obviously been told and were waiting on my return.
I had to pass Limestone Road corner where the bank was. Then I had to pass Oxford Street bus station.
Milkman Richard Young, who had been in a cafe on the Cave Hill Road, had a miraculous escape. He passed three of the explosions.
I heard all the bombs going off, obviously, but no idea where they were till I got home.
Not everyone was so lucky.
Because I'd just had the conversation with him, I heard the news, but it didn't click, because I just spoke to him, so I thought it can't be him.
I can certainly remember about 6:30, all getting a bit anxious what might be happening, with no word from my dad. I think the whole just thing got a bit of a blur from that point on.
I remember being put in front of the telly, watching the monkeys. Being given these strawberries, just sitting there staring at the TV, and I think shell-shocked.
Even up to the last minute, the prospect of political talks had remained alive. 3 days before Bloody Friday, an IRA delegation had a secret meeting with the leader of the opposition, Harold Wilson. The man who set it up was Dr. John O'Connell, an elected member of the Irish Labour Party. On the afternoon of Bloody Friday, leading IRA man Joe Cahill arrived at a house in Dublin to discuss a possible new ceasefire with him.
He went to the house at 4 p.m, but Joe Cahill was running late. He'd been in Belfast and was on his way back. Joe Cahill arrived at the house, but was very distracted and didn't really give my grandfather his full attention and was more concerned with hooking up an aerial into a television in the house. And he saw the images coming through of Bloody Friday. He became upset with Cahill, saying, "Oh, how could you do this? You know, things were going so well. We were so close to a peace. How could you do this?" And Cahill, without even looking at him and completely unapologetically, said, "This is the way it has to be until they come to their senses." My grandfather says that as he watched the images on the television, he became physically sick and very, very upset. He felt utterly betrayed.
Dr. O'Connell wasn't alone in those feelings of revulsion.
My mother and I were sitting by the fireside watching tea time television news. We watched as they shoveled up the pieces. Our telephone rang, and when we answered the call, we were told by my uncle that Tom had been killed. Yes, his body was blown to pieces. There was nothing. There was nothing to bring home.
Joan and her uncle were taken to Musgrave Street Police Station to identify her cousin's personal items.
There were several boxes, big cardboard boxes, with all kinds of everything in there. Handbags, shoes, bits of clothing, jewellery. My uncle had told them that Tom had a ring, a signet ring with his initials on it. And so they produced the ring and said that the only means they had of identifying Tom was by his thumbprint. And it was devastating to watch my little uncle as he took that ring.
18-year-old Billy Irvine had a tattoo on his right arm. That was the only way his brother could recognize his body. Billy Crothers, who had gone home at lunchtime with his wage packet, could only be identified by his clothes.
It was lucky because the guy across the road knew exactly what Billy was wearing, and he had to go to the morgue and he could only identify Billy's body by his jumper.
Stephen Parker's parents faced the ordeal of identifying his body.
My wife waited outside. Body was very badly. His face, head was very badly, disfigured, and but it wasn't possible to recognise him as my son. I felt sorry for the man in the mortuary. He came up and he said, "I don't think that's your son." I said, "Look in the pockets," and of course he pulled out a box of safety matches. And I looked, of course, Stephen had fooled me two nights before. He was always buying these trick games and so on.
They were joke matches?
Joke matches, yes.
Stephen received a posthumous award for bravery for warning people away from the bomb that killed him. The scenes at the bus station were unimaginable. It was hours before anyone could be sure who had lived and who had died. There were six deaths, among them the aspiring footballer 15-year-old Billy Crothers. Billy Irvine, only working that day because he'd swapped shifts with a colleague. And Tom Killips, clerk in the parcels office. The three bus workers died together, searching for the car that contained the bomb. Jackie Gibson, bus driver and father of five, was struck by shrapnel as he paid in his day's takings. Two soldiers from the Welsh Guards were killed. Philip Price, 27, had been clearing the area around the bus station. And Stephen Cooper, the driver, died the day before his 19th birthday.
It was the next morning, and my husband was away at the time, so my parents wouldn't tell me when I was on my own. So it was the next morning that my father came down to tell me.
Afterwards, there were claims and counterclaims about what telephone warnings were given. None, said the police, that gave them time to act.
Because there weren't mobile phones in those days, and I had to rely on public telephones or phones in the houses of supporters, that was a precarious situation.
The IRA blamed the police and army, saying they hadn't responded to the calls. The IRA set out to cause economic damage and gave warnings to avoid any civilian casualties. If the British authorities had acted as they should have, there would not have been any casualties. The truth was, in most cases, the IRA had given warnings. But in the chaos they had created, they were of little use.
Normally the IRA weren't bad at giving warnings in time. But when you've got so many places where they've laid bombs, you're going to get people moving from one bomb into another.
The system couldn't possibly have coped with Bloody Friday, the number of hoax bombs, the number of incidents. Because the IRA brought the road system to a complete standstill, they couldn't get through the traffic to attend to these incidents.
That was the story of the Cave Hill attack. There was a warning, but the bomb sat for an hour in a street busy with shoppers because the police couldn't get to it. At first, the IRA thought Bloody Friday had been a big success.
Bradley told me that he and his commanding officer had gone to the top of one of the high flats in the New Lodge to watch the bombs gone off. And they could hear the crump and bang and watch the black smoke. And it was only when they came down they realised that there were so many casualties and it had been a complete mess.
The following Sunday, members of the Belfast IRA met in a house in Beechmont Grove in West Belfast. Some joked that the bombing would toughen the bastards up, but others said it was a fuck-up and a bollocks.
I remember my Uncle Hugh clinging to the walls, and as a nine-year-old, it was just extraordinary. The house was full of people, and he was actually clinging onto the walls with grief. I mean, his grief was unbelievable.
We buried her on our 12th wedding anniversary.
Billy Crothers had been waiting for a letter from the shipyard. It came just after he died.
He'd got word to say they had an apprenticeship for him, but it was too late then. we'd had the bomb at the bus station, and that was it. I found it so hard. I mean, Billy is with me every day. It's just, excuse me. It's just something I'll never forget. Never, ever. I mean, you don't expect to bury your brother when he's 15, do you? Not in them sort of circumstances, anyway.
For the Parker family, life was never the same. Reverend Parker set up the anti-violence movement, Witness for Peace, and detailed every death in the Troubles. But eventually, worn down by the violence and by their own memories, they emigrated to Canada.
Stephen lived every minute of his life. This is the one thing. He never sat still for a moment. We often, indeed many a time, I said to him, oh, for goodness sake, sit still. Now I just wish he was here making all the noise again. I could say, sit still, Stephen. Be quiet.
130 people were injured. Philip Galt was one of them.
My leg was severed around the back, up to the knee. The leg was basically hanging off at that stage. Yeah. It had been cut open with all the nerves and the muscles severed. So the muscle has gone from here.
Philip has been left with one foot that hasn't grown since he was 9.
It's about a size 4.5, 5.
These days, he's a health and safety officer living with constant pain. Because he has a job, he has to pay for his treatment himself.
It's one thing having the pain in the first place. It's another thing now being told, well, now you have to pay to have the pain. You're talking an average of maybe 60, 70, 80,000 pounds spent over 40 years. I'm actually financially paying for somebody else's criminal activity.
For Hugh, the strict rules of the compensation system added to his grief.
Because Margaret had no income, she was deemed to be no loss. She would have got compensation for her injury. But because she was killed, had no income, no compensation. I just feel, if you want to call it an insult to Margaret's memory, that everybody just passed it by as if she had no meaning in life. It wasn't pounds, shillings and pence, it was just the sheer disregard for human life.
There was a compensation payment in the end.
I got paid for the money. It was blown to pieces.
Jack Campbell lived out the rest of his days with shrapnel from the Oxford Street car bomb in his body.
It sometimes worked its way out, and when it did that, it caused great pain. He had a pain in his face. He would have rubbed it like that. A bit of black shrapnel would come out.
The bomb had permanently damaged his lungs. He eventually died from his injuries, 25 years later.
It just said his greatest wish would have been for a new pair of bellows, and that would have changed his life again. He had been in the Atlantic convoys during the war, and he said if Hitler couldn't beat him, he was pretty sure he wasn't going to let somebody destroy his life by being blown up at his desk work.
Family and housekeepers helped Hugh raise his 7 children, the youngest just a year old when their mother died.
I coped. I just said to myself, I have to do this, I must do it, you know, and I did. And I had to get up in the morning, get to work, try to organise things. You can't sit back, as I say, train the ball and chain behind you. It's too much of a load, so you have to look for the children and see what you can do and get on with things.
The O'Hare children grew into doctors, dentists and business executives, making a success of their lives their mother never lived to share. For all but the grieving families, Bloody Friday was just a single thread in the tapestry of the Troubles. They felt they were the forgotten victims.
A lot of people feel that they don't have a hearing. It just seemed to meld into history.
You didn't discuss it, and you wouldn't have been fine discussing it.
It was nearly expected, you know, stiff upper lip, get yourself together, get on with it. It was a very cold, callous world, but that's how people survived in the Troubles back in the 70s.
Around 150 IRA members carried out the bombings that day. Just three were convicted, and only one served a jail term. The IRA never attempted anything on the same scale again. Shortly after Bloody Friday, Seamus Toomey, the Belfast commander, left for Dublin. On the 30th anniversary in 2002, the IRA apologised for killing civilians on that day. Last year, Gerry Adams was asked what role he played.
None. I regret very much that we had a conflict. I regret that so many people died in the course of that conflict, most particularly, you know, innocent civilians, people who had no role to play whatsoever, were caught up in the wrong place at the wrong time. And I think all of that is something that I'm very, very sorry about.
The day before Bloody Friday, Stephen Cooper wrote home. He said he was enjoying himself in Belfast, and his work was interesting.
The biggest question with anyone that dies suddenly like that is why? An innocent young man, gone. Without, you know, living properly.
I don't really know what their thinking is. I never could figure it out. Absolute mindless morons who would plant a bomb outside a block of small shops. Who are the customers going to be at 2 o'clock on the Friday afternoon? Women and children.
I would quote a American playwright who said that there's no flag large enough to cover the shame of killing innocent people. And I think that's all I could say, because it was all done, I suppose, in the name of a flag. It doesn't matter what the flag is. It was a shameful act.
The only question I ever asked was, did they achieve anything by blowing me up? I don't care what they say about the peace process. Did they achieve anything by blowing me up in 72? I was a 9-year-old child. Explain how that achieved a goal, because it's beyond me.